Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And in our ongoing series on Nobel Prize winners, tonight we're going to talk about Dr. Charles Kao, who died recently at the age of 84. Dr. Kao was awarded half of the 2009 Nobel Prize in Physics for his work in the 1960s on the transmission of light through extremely small glass fibers and essentially starting the fiber optic revolution in communication. As parenthetically, the other half of the Nobel Prize that year was awarded jointly to Willard Boyle and George Smith for inventing imaging semiconductor circuits. But it's Dr. Kao who can legitimately be called the father of fiber optic communication. The rapid transmission of signals over long distances is fundamental to the flow of information. Since the 1930s, thin filaments or fibers of glass were used to see inside the body, but those long remained unusable for long-distance information transfer because too much light was lost along the way. The prevailing school of thought until the 1960s was that was a limitation of the theoretical ability to transfer light through glass. Dr. Kao proved otherwise. He proved that the theory was right and that the light lost was due to microscopic impurities in the glass rather than a flaw in the theory. His solution was fibers of very pure glass, and together with laser technology, his solution made telecommunication using optical fibers possible even across continents. Dr. Kao was a nice Chinese boy born in Shanghai before World War II. After the war, his family moved from Shanghai to Hong Kong as Mao Zedong and the communists threatened to take over the Chinese mainland. He traveled to England when he was a teenager to study electrical engineering in England and eventually made his way to the Standard Telecommunication Laboratory, which was the world center for fiber optic study. The critical work occurred in 1966 after he and a group of researchers had produced an ultra-pure optical fiber more than half a mile long. He and British engineer George Hockham published a paper in November of 1965, one of the most important physics papers of the 20th century, called Dielectric Fiber Surface Waveguides for Optical Frequencies, where he noted that a fiber of glassy material and certain dimensions represents a possible practical optical waveguide with important potential as a new form of communication medium. In layman's terms, this meant that light could be transmitted over long distances and transferred into a form of information. Here's a brief report in 1966 on Dr. Kao's work from the Standard Telecommunications Laboratory in Great Britain.
Charles Kao, the pioneer of optical fiber communication, working in the laboratory, experimenting with a prototype hair-thin optical fiber made of glass. He was part of the British team that first proposed that huge quantities of information might be carried over vast distances by this novel means. This was only the beginning. The transmission loss of these early fibers was so great that many argued that Charles's vision was doomed to failure. However, later that year, Charles and George Hockham published the defining paper, which revealed that none of the current imperfections were fundamental. A helium neon gas laser, invented just a few years earlier, which provided a sufficiently bright light to launch into the incredibly tiny core of the single mode fiber. The intensity of the laser light was modulated, and that information traveled along the fiber as pulses of light, which were converted back to an electrical signal at the far end. All this pioneering work was carried out at Standard Telecommunication Laboratories at Harlow in England, now recognized as the birthplace of optical fiber communication.
Not sure the British ever gave him the full credit for this discovery, but the Nobel Committee did, even if it was 43 years after the critical work. Here they introduce him for the Nobel Lecture in 2009, which was actually given by his wife who worked with him because he had developed neurologic problems.
The Physics Prize this year is awarded for work that has had a profound effect, not only on science, but on directly to all of us in our daily life. It has become quite common that we can phone someone in another continent, another part of the world, and speak to her or him as if the person was in the same room. The sound quality and the fidelity is so high. We have also become used to following news, video, and pictures from various parts of the world when events appear. in real time. These things are very natural and common for us. And if we look back a decade or two, we realize that this is something that has really happened and had a profound effect on our daily life. The instant connection that we have to various information sources all over the world is present today, and we get the information that we need in terms of text, video, music, and so on. These things that are present and very useful for us today in society are very much due to the work of this year's Nobel laureates in physics. The prize this year is divided into two parts, one for the work on optical fibers for long-distance communication, and the other half for the invention of the CCD sensor, which allows digital photography and video. The first one being given then to describe the work on optical fibers, the work that awards Dr. Charles Kuen Kao to one half of the prize. Let me say just a few words about Dr. Kao. He was born 1933 in Shanghai. He moved to Hong Kong and later fairly young to England, where he got his PhD in electroengineering in 1965. He was already then employed at the Standard Telecommunication Laboratories in Harlow, England. He worked there for quite a long time. He became director of engineering. Then, after a few decades, actually, he also went back to Hong Kong, where he became vice chancellor of the Chinese University of Hong Kong. He was retired in 1996. Dr. Kao, the motivation for the prize to Dr. Kao is for groundbreaking achievements concerning the transmission of light in fibers for optical communication.
A few years before he was awarded the Nobel Prize, Dr. Kao did an interview at Stanford where he described his work. You'll hear him refer to STL, that's the Standard Telecommunications Laboratory in Harlow that was mentioned before. And you'll also hear him refer to that landmark paper he published with Hockham and tell how groundbreaking it was.
Dr. Kao, thank you for joining us today in beautiful Palo Alto, and nice to have you here to talk about the history and your role in it and fiber optics.
Thank you. I started work in industry in 1957 and joined the research lab in 1970. By the time I get really into the fiber work, it was already in 1963. Prior to my fiber work, I was working on microwave systems. First of all, on the 6 gigahertz point-to-point microwave link, it's pure development work of a product. When I went to STL, that's a research lab, I decided that that's a very wonderful time to joining the sort of new generations of wideband transmission medium. That was, first of all, the circular microwave millimetric waveguide. So I was working at the starting point of 1960 on circular waveguide and its related activities.
The work you performed at STL was based on millimeter waveguides. When did the attention turn to the possibility of using optical fibers as a potential medium to investigate?
I really joined when STL was already thinking about optical communications, because by 1959, laser was invented and everybody got excited. But at STL, Reeves recognized that optical frequency as a carrier wave should be exploited as early as possible. So he started the work of using optical signal generated by a hollow cathode tube, which has a very small spot, very bright spot of light generated as a plasma. And they were already doing experiments for optical communications. And so when I joined, the work was started, but I was not directly involved, but I'm peripherally involved because the two labs are working very closely. By 1963, Kabovyak decided that besides the millimetric waveguide project, which was ongoing, STL should start looking at alternatives to free space propagation as well as real guided propagation using dielectric material.
In November 1965, George Hockham and yourself released a paper to the Proceedings of the Institution of Electrical Engineers titled Dielectric Fiber Surface Waveguides for Optical Frequencies. This paper even today addresses the issues that are viable. The paper's six main topics address the dielectric fiber waveguide, the material, the electromagnetic, and the physical aspects of the fibers, and reviews the experiments and the results. The conclusion itself opens the door the visionary must have been as well. Can you expand on the paper, and then let's address the vision beyond the paper?
Well, at that time, when optical communication was regarded as a possibility, all the people in the transmission business says this is something that's going to change the communication world very significantly. So we were all very excited. We can put so much more information onto the transmission medium and so on and so forth. So the excitement was there. And when this paper was written, we see that it really can meet all the requirements. And so I was really very excited about that and say that's why in the publicity that occurred afterwards, we were saying, hey, this thing will allow us to do all sorts of things that were at that time very brave to be stated by the PR people, like it might go across the ocean and send very many messages simultaneously across great distances and so on. But that was all speculation at that time. However, based on the paper, you can see that that should be a reality. And interestingly, the paper's accuracy was very, very high.
How does it feel now to look back at all the changes and the achievements that have occurred due to your perseverance and achievement?
Thinking about it now, instead of sort of reflecting on how I envisaged it then, I think perseverance is necessary. However, I was so enthused about it that time seems to pass by very quickly and progress seems to be continuously being made. And so I had a very satisfying life with respect to my association with the fiber. I regard the fiber's success as one of demonstration of really a concerted work from many, many people in many countries. And it was very satisfying to see that fiber indeed live up to its expectations.
I think when you consider the current use of optical cable fiber worldwide, it more than lived up to its expectations. Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tepps, and to honor Dr. Kao, we have to have a song about glass. And there's a lot of songs about glass, but I think we're going to do one by Miss Peggy Lee. It's a lesser-known song from the 60s, written by a Brazilian, Luiz Bonfá, and a nice Jewish boy, Dick Manning. And in the mid-60s, around the time that Dr. Kao was discovering fiber optic transmission in England, across the Atlantic, they'd be pouring Peggy into one of those too tight dresses at the Copa, and she'd do a bunch of songs, including this one. It's called This Empty Glass. There's currently a nice tribute to Peggy Lee by Mark Stein on his website, specifically about her great hit Fever. Peggy may have been a diva, but hey, there weren't too many who could sing like her. And frankly, I think we need more Peggy Lee on this program. So as a final tribute to Dr. Charles Kao, here is This Empty Glass.
Close the door and pour the wine. Fill your glass, but don't fill mine. Here's to you now for the last time. Here's to me, your sometime pastime. Here's to love, an empty glass.